difícil para mí porque cuando estoy en México estoy hablando una mezcla de inglés, de español y de francés. Entonces voy a tratar de hablar en inglés porque mi presentación está en inglés, pero después podemos hablar en español si quiere preguntar algunas cosas. Entonces, le voy a presentar voy a cambiar. My presentation will be dedicated to the modeling of the behavior of heterogeneous material with viscoelastic matrix with application to asphalt concrete. The problem we are dealing with can be found on this picture. You can see that in some heterogeneous material, you have a matrix which can have some viscoelastic behavior and discrete solid element, you can see here, which are included in this matrix. As example, we can consider a mixture of sand and clay, bituminous material, and other kind of material. And these heterogeneous materials have a rather complex behavior linked to the complex texture of the material. And we have considered this problem. And we have proposed some new trend to define this behavior. So an asphalt concrete, you know, this is a sample of asphalt concrete which contain mineral aggregates around 85% and asphalt which bound these aggregates. The behavior of this kind of materials is depending on the loading velocity, depending on the temperature, and depending on possible cracking between the aggregates. And this behavior is depending on the composition of the considered material. So we are dealing with some reference asphalt concrete, which is called GB3. The constitution of this material is a matrix with pure asphalt. 30, 50 is a number which is depending on the characteristic of the asphalt, and there is some mineral aggregates which is composed of continuous grading between 0.05 millimeter to 14 millimeter. So you have here the There is no. You have here the percentage in volume of the void aggregates and asphalt. This material has shown viscoelastic behavior linked to the asphalt and with the behavior depending on the loading velocity and the temperature. And the characterization of the behavior of this kind of material is obtained from cyclic loading. So this cyclic loading are usually applied on strain, imposed strain in the vertical direction, and we measure. So the imposed loading is defined on the vertical strain, and we measure the vertical stress, and the horizontal strain. And you can see here that there is some discrepancy between the different sine curves, and this different discrepancy can be taken into account, but this what we call angle of phase, which can be defined for the major stress here and here for the horizontal strain. So from this cyclic loading, we have defined the different strain and stress, and we can consider that this periodic function can be expressed also in the complex plane. Here we have the complex plane with the real part and an imaginary part, and we can express the vertical strain, the vertical stress, and the horizontal strain very easily in this imaginary plane. We have the major the angle of major stress phase and the angle of Poisson ratio phase. We can define the complex Young modulus by this very classical formula, and we can also define the complex Poisson ratio by this also very classical formula. And we can have for the Young modulus and for the Poisson ratio, we have two parts, an imaginary part and a real part. And usually we have this representation of the behavior of this kind of material here for the complex modulus. You have here the real part and here the imaginary part. You don't consider the black drawing. You consider only the color drawing. This color drawing correspond to different temperature. So for different temperature, you have the complex modulus, which can be defined with a real part and a imaginary part. And here, this representation correspond to different only one frequency and different temperature from minus 23 to plus 39. So, considering all this experimental data, you can draw this representation, and this representation is called the Kolkol representation. You can have the same representation for the Poisson ratio, the complex Poisson ratio, and the you have another representation which is called the black representation. In this case, you consider the angle of phase, for example, for the modulus, in function of the modulus of the Young modulus. And the same here, the angle of phase for the Poisson ratio in function of the modulus of the Poisson ratio. All these representations are classical for this kind of viscoelastic material. So, I talk about material rheologically simple and principle of equivalence. You have seen that for a given frequency, we have different results depending on the temperature. It is the same if you analyze the experimental result for a given temperature and for different frequency. So it is relatively difficult to have two parameters, to have a behavior we depend on two parameters. So many analysis, many experimental analysis have shown that some of these viscoelastic materials can be considered are rheologically simple because you can find different you can obtain the same value of the complex Young modulus and of the complex Poisson ratio for different couples of temperature and frequency. So you can obtain this kind of result, and we can pass from one couple to another couple by a relation which has been defined by Williams, Landel, Ferry. So you can see here, for example, if you are looking on the left, it is the result of the Young modulus, the modulus of the Young modulus in relation with the frequency of the cyclic test. So if you are considering only the frequency, you have the color point. So you can see that in this case, if you change the temperature, you have different curves. But if you use the law proposed by William Landel and Ferry, we consider that we can use some translation coefficient, AD, which is defined with respect to a reference temperature. You can, in this case, you consider not only the frequency, but the product between this factor, which is defined here by the frequency, and all the points are on the same curve, which is called the master curve. So this is obtained for the Young modulus, the modulus of the Young modulus, but also for the angle of phase for the Young modulus, and the same kind of result can be obtained for the Poisson ratio. And you can see here this relation, which is a relation which can be defined for each material by some experimental test. So you have these parameters which are depending on the material. So usually phenomenological models are considered to model the behavior of these materials. And in my laboratory, there is some team which is very focused on this domain, and they have developed what they have called the 2S2P1D model. And this model is a rheological model which is composed of two springs, two elements with parabolic creep, one dashpot. And this model was complex to be used, and this model can be approximated by a general a generalized Kelvin model, Kelvin void model. And you know the Kelvin void model, which is very simple, a dashpot and a spring in parallel. And this approximation is good if you are considering a number of a great number of this Kelvin void model. So you can have here, for example, in the call plane we have seen before, you have here the model, which is this model, and you have here the approximation considering 15 kV model. So if you use more model in the approximation, you will obtain a better approximation. So, okay. So, now, these different Kelvin void model are not completely, cannot be defined. They have some relation between the value of the viscosity and the value of the Young modulus, the value of the Young modulus of each spring. And this relation is given here for the material we have defined at the beginning of this talk. You have here the relation between what we call the characteristic time. Characteristic time is another way to define the viscosity, because this characteristic time is equal to the viscosity of the Young modulus of the considered Kelvin void model. So you have here the relation between E and Xi, corresponding to the material we are analyzing. So now we have talked only on phenomenological modeling. And in the phenomenological modeling, there is some limitation, because usually, you have seen before, in particular here, we have a great number of parameters which have no clear physical meaning, usually. In some cases, perhaps you can have, but usually they have no clear physical meaning. And there is no clear links between the internal structure, the internal texture, the internal composition of the material and the phenomenological model and the parameter of this phenomenological model. So, in material science, many research have tried to use what we call an upscaling approach. That is to say, it is difficult to define the behavior at what we call the representative elementary volume. So we are passing to another scale, and perhaps, it's not true, you can have a more easy behavior to be defined at this local scale. First point, it is necessary to define what is the local scale, and in some case we have different local scale you can use, and Usually you have to choose between these different local scale. So in this upscaling approach, you can take usually into account the internal texture, because at the local level, you can define usually this internal texture. And the upscaling approach can give the global behavior of at the sample scale as a phenomenological approach, but also can give very interesting result at the local level. For example, local strain, local stress, we have talked before of some problem of fracking, for example, and propagation of fracking, and using this kind of approach seems of great interest to analyze this kind of problem. So I will show you how we can use this upscaling approach. This is a very classical presentation of upscaling approach. Usually you are interested by the global constitutive law at the representative elementary volume. And usually this global constitutive law is a relation between stress and strain, but with all the variables depending on the complexity of this law. And you can define this relation not directly, but passing to a local level. So from the stress, you can define usually some local variable linked to sigma. Then you have to define some local constitutive law, and you obtain some local variable linked to epsilon, to the strain, and then you can return to the global level to obtain the global deformation. So you have two paths. You can start from the stress to arrive to the strain, or you can start from the stress to the from the strain to arrive to the stress. This is the very general formulation of the very simple here, this upscaling approach. So there is different upscaling approach. The more simple, which has been developed many years ago, are analytical approach for local simple behavior, for example, elasticity and material with periodic texture. And for more complex material, you can use some numerical approach, in particular finite element method and distinct element method. So I am my main approach since many years is using the tool, very interesting tool of the distinct element method. So we have tried using this method to develop a numerical upscaling approach to adapt to analyze the behavior of this viscoelastic material. So what is the distinct element method? This method has been defined by Peter Kendall in 79, and is used today very, very classically, very commonly in many research laboratories. The hypotheses are very simple. You have many particles in we are considering a set of particles, particular rich digit. Deformation can occur at each contact, which is taken into account in the method, in the numerical method, by small overlaps at contact, and the contact law generally considered for this analysis are very simple and are based on local elasticity with local friction. So you can see here, for example, that we are passing from the sample with many particles. The behavior of this sample is very complex, because if you are considering phenomenological model, you have to take into account elastoplasticity, and even with elastoplastic model, you never have a very, very good model for this kind of material. I have developed many kind of phenomenological model for granular material, and I never reached to have a very, very efficient model for every kind of very complex path, for example, very complex loading, for example, with very cyclic loading and so on. So you can see here that when changing the level of the analysis, you can define very simple local law. And the discipline, so what is, how it works, this method? Very simple. You consider that at the boundary, you change the boundary, you apply some displacement at the boundary of the considered sample. This displacement will lead to some displacement of particles, and then some particle overlaps. Then from this local overlaps, you using the very simple local contact law, you can define the contact force. You can sum this contact force on each particle. You obtain the resultant force and torque on each particle. You apply the Newton law and you obtain the particle acceleration. All these different points are considered at the same time t. So you consider that this acceleration is constant during an increment of time delta t. So from this acceleration, which is considered constant during delta t, you can integrate this acceleration two times, and you obtain the displacement of all the particles at time t plus delta t, and you can continue on all particles, on all contact, and you can obtain the position of all particles and the force between all particles, and from this element you can compute at each time, you can compute the stress on the sample, and you can compute the strain on this sample. If you want to know more on this method, you can assist to, you can attend the thesis of Jesus Sanchez tomorrow. But it is not exactly what we have used in this research program, because an asphalt concrete is not a granular material without any bound between particles. So we have to adapt the program to consider the specificity of asphalt concrete. For the usual granular material, we have usually large displacement of particles, large evolution of the internal texture, and there is some numerical difficulty to define the contacts at each step of time, which are changing all along a loading. Forces are only located on actual contact between particles, and usually a very simple contact law is used, elastic law with friction. For asphalt concrete, there is some particular point which can be considered. We have very small displacement of aggregates in the asphalt concrete, so very small evolution of the internal texture, so the neighboring aggregate of a given aggregate do not change all along a loading. Force are occurring between aggregate in contact, but also aggregate which are not in contact, but which are in relation one to another through an asphalt interface. So this point is very different from what it is occurring in classical granular material. And last point, the interface law between aggregates are necessarily complex because it takes into account some asphalt interface, so it is necessary to take into account viscoelastic behavior. So it is necessary to adapt the DEM. So how we have adapted this usual numerical method? So we have tried to define a numerical SEMP, more or less similar to the reference material. So this is the reference material, the grading of the reference material. So we have considered that we can take into account all the aggregated with size is greater than 1 millimeter, and all these small particles are considered are belonging to mastic. Mastic is a mixture between grain less with a dimension less than 1 millimeter plus asphalt plus void. So the simplification we have dealing with is that we have considered spherical shape of aggregate because it is more easy to analyze, and that the mastic is taken only into account by the interface law we have considered between aggregates. So the mastic is not a material, it is a link defined between different aggregates. So you have here the numerical sample. We have considered only 10,000 particles, we can use more, but the calculation take more times. So you can see that considering the grading, you have many particles which are in 1 millimeter and 2 millimeter, and after the number of particles, of large particles, are very few, very small. So how to define the interaction network between all these particles. Because usually in classical granular material, we cannot take into account the interaction between two particles which are not in contact. So the difficulty was to define this interaction network. So we start from the some particle, the position of the particle are defined at random and with a correct porosity. So there is no interaction network in this case. So after we apply some isotropic compression, you have a first interaction network because some particles are in contact. After we have applied some swelling of particles without contact to obtain the maximum of contact of the particle, to define what are the particles around some particle, for example, the yellow particle, which have no contact. It is important to know what are the interactions they can develop with other particles. So you can see here that the swelling of this particle allows to define some interaction, another interaction, another interaction, and so on. So you can see that all the yellow particle, for all the yellow particle, we have defined the interaction. So from this this position, we have to return to the real value, the actual value of the size of particle. So the program take in, we consider that this interaction is completely defined and this interaction will not change in the future. So here, this interaction remain, but the size of the particle return to the initial size. So after we have some little change to return to the correct porosity of the sample. So at the end, we have defined more or less all the possible interaction between the particle through some mastic interface. And for doing this, we have used very simple local contact model with a local spring. So very simple local constitutive law, because it is only to define the interaction network. So you have here we have analyzed the distribution of this interaction network, and we can see that as we have used some isotropically process, we obtain an isotropic distribution of, there is no anisotropy in this sample. So you can see here the number of interaction for the first network, only aggregate in contact, and here the number of interaction for at the end of the process we have used, considering all the interaction, considering some mastic interface. And you can see that what we call the coordination number, which is the number of contact, the mean value of the number of contact, it is 5 here, and it is 6.12 here. define the local behavior. So first we are considering elasticity. After we will see how to consider viscoelasticity. So in this case, we are considering that the interface can be approximated by some cylinder with a radius which is the value of the smaller radius of the two particles which are interacting. So this radius is the first characteristic of the interface. The length petit a is another characteristic of this interaction of this interface, and this ratio surface above the length is interesting because it can be used for calculating the rigidity of this interface is given here. So if we are calculating the normal rigidity, it is very simple. It is a very simple calculation. In the method, we have to define at each contact or at each interaction some relation between force and local displacement. So the rigidity is the parameter ruling the displacement delta A and the force which are applied between at this interface. So if we have some this force is applied on a surface A, this force is sigma A, so you can develop here and you can show that here you have some local Young modulus E which can be defined with, and these are the geometrical characteristic of the interface. So you can see that here we have defined some local elastic characteristic depending on the geometry of the local interface. So this is interesting because you can see that we can take into account the local texture. So here some experimental result. So when you are dealing with viscoelastic material, we have two asymptotic behavior. If you are considering high temperature or low frequency, it is here, you have an elastic behavior. And if you are considering low temperature but high frequency, you obtain another elastic behavior. And question, it is sure of this? It is sure because if you are analyzing here the value of the angle phase of the Young modulus, you can see that this angle of phase is equal to zero here and is equal to zero here. So if the angle of phase is equal to zero, it is clear that the behavior at this point is elastic behavior. And you can see that in this between these two asymptotic behavior, you have a viscoelastic behavior, which can be put in evidence because the angle of phase is very different from zero. So we have the same kind of result for the Poisson ratio, and we obtain the asymptotic behavior for this material. At low frequency and high temperature, you have this result, and at high frequency and low temperature, you obtain this result. So now, is it possible to define, to consider local parameter which can be considered to obtain the result given by the experimental test? So for this, first we consider, in fact, we have three local parameters. So we'll put all on me transparency. So you can see here that in this analysis we have taken at the interface only elastic behavior. Because the viscosity is not taken into account in this asymptotic elastic behavior. So you can see that here you have normal rigidity, and here you have a tangential rigidity. And usually what we consider that is that tangential rigidity is equal to the normal rigidity multiplied by a parameter called alpha. So in the first analysis, we have considered to analyze what is the value of alpha which can match with the experimental result. So you analyze the value of the coefficient, the Poisson ratio, and this Poisson ratio is not depending on the value of parameter E, which is the Young modulus of at the local level. So we use some mean value of E, and we obtain for 0.25, which is here, we obtain the value of alpha 0 equal 0.06. And the value of 0.45, we don't reach to obtain this value because we only have obtained 0.35. So this is a point we have to be considered in future research to how to increase the value of the Poisson ratio. And for this, it is 0.005. It is a problem. So we have used this value for the low temperature and high frequency, and this for high temperature and low frequency. So we use this parameter in considering the analysis of the value of E with respect the influence of local Young modulus to global Young modulus, and you obtain very linear relationship, which is very normal. And so we can define for the value we are looking for here, the value of the local Young modulus, and here the value of the local Young modulus. So we have defined the elastic parameter if you are considering only the asymptotic behavior, which are elastic behavior. So now we consider viscoelastic behavior, and we consider the numerical simulation. So for this, we have seen before that the phenomenological model called 2S2P1D has been approximated by a generalized Kelvin void model. A generalized Kelvin void model is a different Kelvin void model in series, and we are considering that the main idea in our work is that we don't consider all this series of Kelvin void model, but we consider that we will take only a part of this model, and we put one of the 15 model we put between to define the interface. So here we applied a rather complicated model with 15 model in series, and here we use very simple local model, but this very simple model are distributed in the sample. So, how to take into account this local model? So, this local model are defined here for the normal interaction, and here in the two case we have a Kelvin void model associated to a spring. A Kelvin void model associated to the spring. So it is necessary to define all these parameters. For the elastic behavior, the two spring, it is very easy because we have defined the behavior, the asymptotic behavior, and so to obtain the asymptotic behavior, you can see that if you have at low frequency or high temperature, the dashpot does not play any role, and then you can consider that this spring can be the spring we have defined at low F or high temperature when we have talk about asymptotic model. And for very high frequency or low temperature, there is no strain allowed in the dashpot. So in this case, only the strain is given only by this spring. So in this case, it is very easy to consider that this spring is a spring defined when we are deal with the asymptotic model. So we have defined all the spring in our model, and the only problem is to define the viscosity. So the viscosity We don't deal with the viscosity, but we deal with what we call the characteristic time. One can be computed from the other. So it is interesting to notice that in all this model, we have local geometric characteristic, and we have some local characteristic with the viscosity and the Young modulus of the spring. So the only point we have to deal with is the characteristic time. We have considered that the 15 model corresponding to the 15 Kelvin void model in the KVG phenomenological model have to be associated to the different interface. The 15 model are characterized by the three parameter. The different interface are characterized by their geometry, and the different interface have been classified by parameter A of small a, which is related to the local rigidity. So the hypothesis we have considered is that the 15 values of xi has the same as in the GKV phenomenological model, and the only point which have to deal with is how to distribute this value on the different interface. So five hypotheses on the link between the model number and the value of A over A interval have been considered and analyzed. So this is one of these hypotheses. I will not present the other hypothesis. So the different interval of the A over R ratio is here, and we have all the 15 model. So one of the distribution we consider is to give to the interval which are in this domain the value of xi one, etc., until xi 50. But this can be, it is an hypothesis which have to be analyzed more clearly. So you can see here some simulation test, and you can see that the hypothesis we have considered on the distribution of xi have a very great influence, because you can see here the axial stress, and you can see here that the axial stress is very different from this hypothesis than from this hypothesis. So we analyze the different influence of this hypothesis on the result. So you have here some experimental result here in green color, and the different hypothesis. And you can see here that the hypothesis one is very good for the modulus of the Young modulus at the frequencies we have the first frequency we have analyzed. So this is for new. In this case, the hypothesis we have consider is not so good. I don't know. I think it is more or less here. You can see here that hypothesis one is not very far from the the curve, and you can see here also that hypothesis 1 seems to be better than the other. So we have considered this hypothesis, and in this case we have analyzed for different temperature. So here is the curve we can obtain for different experimental result and different simulation result with different temperature. So you can see here that the result on the modulus of the Young modulus is rather good. The result for the angle of phase for the Young modulus is rather good, and the result for the Poisson ratio is not very good. But the experimental results for the Poisson ratio are very, very difficult to obtain, and the simulation are also very difficult to analyze, because the measure of the deformation in the horizontal direction is very small. Well, but the results are not good. So you have another representation. It is here the representation in the cold plane of the Young modulus. You can see that here there are some part of the curve which is not very good. Here in the black representation, it is not so bad. And for the Poisson ratio, results are very chaotic. So now we can, so we some last information on the local, some local information. And this is very interesting, because this kind of information cannot be obtained from phenomenological model. You can see here the distribution of the normal interaction force, and you can see that these forces are in compression and are in tension also. And you have here another representation of the compression value and the extension value, which are given in function of the ratio A over R. You can see here at the end of the cyclic loading the distribution of the interaction force for compression and tension. So pay attention, because the scale is not the same. So you can see here that the force in compression are higher than the force in tension. But it is interesting to note the value of this force in tension. This was in the horizontal plane. So you can see here that the distribution is more or less isotropic, and we have also another distribution in the vertical plane, and you can see here that distribution is very high in isotropic, with here the greater value in compression are in the vertical direction, and the greater value for the tension force are in the horizontal direction. All these results are very classical, but here we can have some value, some local value, and this is very interesting. So, as conclusion, we have proposed some definition of method for the building of a discrete numerical sample of asphalt concrete. We have defined the parameter of the local simple viscoelastic law from the model, the phenomenological model. We have analyzed the influence of the distribution of the local model considered between aggregate, but this point needs complementary research work, and the analysis of the local effort between aggregates have shown relevant results and can be used, for example, for the analysis of local phenomena such as local cracking. So, as prospect, we can consider that we can analyze the influence of the composition of the material and of the process of creating this asphalt concrete on its internal texture and on the behavior of the global material. And we can use the local information for the analysis of local phenomena, such as local cracking, birth and development. Okay, thank you for your attention. It is for me a very new subject. Because usually as I am working on granular material, and here with a team which is working on asphalt concrete in our laboratory, we have decided to work both to try to have a new approach on this kind of material. So I am not a specialist of asphalt material.
I suppose it's another basic, in addition to the hypothesis that you mentioned, I suppose that you are also considering that the individual solid particles do not contribute to the formation, right?
Yes.
Except, which is a reasonable assumption, except near failure.
The hypothesis, the basic hypothesis in this kind of numerical approach is that the deformation of the particle are not taken into account only if there is some contact. You can have small deformation on the contact, but all the deformation are only defined at the contact or at the interaction as we have defined here.
Which is a reasonable assumption, except near failure, right?
But in asphalt concrete, the deformation is localized essentially in the asphalt.
El otro enfoque del elemento finito no lo están desarrollando, porque realmente aquí el medio no es un medio discreto realmente, sino que las deformaciones son pequeñas, las partículas pueden estar ahogadas dentro de la matriz.
Es un medio discreto porque hay como se dice en español,
agregado.
Que están en interacción. Y entonces, si se van a utilizar un medio continuo, es posible.
Usualmente.
Sí, very difficult for me. Usualmente se usa medio modelo de medio continuo, pero en este caso no puede tener ninguna información local que tiene en cuenta el hecho que hay dos materiales very diferentes, que son los agregados y la matriz. Pero
se puede atribuir propiedades muy diferentes a las partículas y al fluido, ¿no? O sea, al elemento finito.
O sea, sí, se puede, sí. Pero en este caso eso...
O sea, me imagino que para altos porcentajes de agregados, ahí sí puede haber una estructura, digamos, de los granos que solamente los modelos discretos la pueden referir.
Sí,
pero en el caso de que de bajos porcentajes...
En hecho, es muy... hay poco... el asfalto es más o menos 10-11%. Y los agregados es 85 o 90.
Sí, hay una estructura.
Entonces hay muy pocas asfalto. Entonces, acaso,
bueno, está bien.
Es una parte de, se puede discutir.
No, está bien. ¿Preguntas? ¿De veras no hay pregunta? Bueno, pues si no hay más preguntas, voy a terminar por donde debía haber empezado, es decir, presentar al doctor Campo, porque muchos llegaron un poco tarde y empezamos la conferencia. Quiero recordar nada más que el doctor Cambú ha estado aquí en el instituto hace muchos años, ¿hace cuántos años? ¿40?
Sí.
Trabajando con el profesor Marsal en varios temas, incluyendo la fricción entre partículas. Me acuerdo que desarrolló un equipo para medir la fricción entre partículas de enrocamiento y en otros temas también, inclusive juntos, todos haciendo cosas. Y curiosamente, como 30 años después, ¿verdad?, nos volvimos a encontrar y ha habido interacción y qué bueno, ¿no? Bienvenido nuevamente aquí a México. Entonces, pues para agradecerle, parece que por aquí le han preparado un pequeño diploma y un regalito.
Muchas gracias.
Un aplauso, ¿no? Y esperamos que esta nueva colaboración, un poco tardía, se siga dando. Hay que hacer artículos aquí con Jesús.
Sí.
Y les vuelvo a invitar mañana entonces a la presentación de la tesis de Jesús. Está un poco relacionado también con mucho con esos temas. Eso es a las 11 en el auditorio Raúl Marsal de la División de Estudios de Posgrado. Muchas gracias.
El tema que desarrolló Jesús Sánchez es más cerca que de lo que estoy acostumbrado a trabajar, y el tema que he presentado hoy estaba un poco raro para mí también.